So welcome, everybody. My name is Micha Sifri. I'm the co-founder of Civic Hall. Welcome to Civic Hall, if you haven't been here before. We are a community center for civic tech, for people who work on using technology for the public good. You are in our event space, where we are pleased to hold events like these 7 days a week. If you haven't visited our community workspace, which is on the other side of the building, feel free to sort of check it out on your way out. I'm here to answer questions. Our staff are here as well. If you're interested in joining or maybe hosting an event here, you're absolutely welcome to do that. So today we're here for the launch of the Ranking Digital Rights Report. And I have to say that it's a personal thrill for me to be able to help launch the report here at Civic Hall. Rebecca MacKinnon, the prime author and the driving force behind this report, is an old friend. I think I've known Rebecca from practically the early 2000s when she and Ethan Zuckerman started Global Voices Online. She has been a fighter and a champion for digital rights from that point forward. She's been educating the rest of us in many, many ways. And if you haven't read her book, The Consent of the Networked, it's a must read. It's one of the, I'd say, most critical books that any of us in this field have written on the world that we're in and what we need to fight for. So do go get The Consent of the Networked if you haven't read it already. Here's how things are going to work. Rebecca has this enormous and incredibly valuable report, which is now available online. We're going to invite her up to talk, basically to give you the top line findings. And we'll give her about 20 minutes to do that. There's really a lot of meat in this report. And then we've got two distinguished guests who are going to come up and help comment on it. Peter Misek from Access Now and Ellery Biddle from Global Voices. And we'll have a little bit of Q&A together, and then we're going to open it up to the audience and take questions. This event is being live streamed, and the hashtag for it is Ranking Rights. So if you're tweeting about it or you want to follow along, and in fact, if you are watching online and want to ask a question, use that hashtag Ranking Rights, and we'll try and pull some of those questions in as well when we get up to that. So, without any further ado, let me give you Rebecca MacKinnon.
This is really, actually really special that Micah's doing this because, as he mentioned, we've known each other for a while now, and Micah's been giving me platforms and helping me out ever since we met, and I just really want to say that the work Micah does, both with Civic Hall, but over the past 10 years with Personal Democracy Forum and all of these other platforms, has provided really important platform for conversation, for amplification of ideas, for projects, for connecting people. And plus your own books, which everyone should read as well. But Micah's a real connective tissue, I think, in this community and amongst different communities working on civic tech and digital rights and other things, technology and politics. And so really thank you. Also, before I get into this, a few other thanks. My team who've been working on this, there's been a lot of people involved with this report, but there's only three full-time people, two of whom are in the room today. Myself, Priya Kumar, our research analyst, who without whom I would be dead, and Alon Barr, it's true, and Alon Barr, who is not here today, he's in Berlin, he's you know, say hi to him through the internet, he's with us virtually, without whom our data would never have, I just don't even want to think. But also who has really, you know, is a real specialist in internet and human rights and has been vital in terms of thinking through how we're evaluating companies and being consistent in our standards. I also want to thank Sustainalytics, the investment research firm, who are our partners. There's more information about them on their website and in our materials. We worked with a network of researchers around the world who helped us out, who contributed, so thanks to all of you. I won't go through the whole list. Their names are online on the website. And also, we want to thank Development Seed, who did our data visualization on the website. Really great work, and you can go on the website and poke through all the data. You can download the data, et cetera. As I'm talking, I'll be talking about top-line findings. We did hand out a little brochure that sort of gives you sort of an overview of our findings and a bit of an overview of sort of the top line data, but definitely you'll want to go onto the website and explore, and you can also download the raw data as well. So finally, my final thanks is to the funders of this thing. We are obviously not taking corporate money, that would be weird, but Open Society Foundations, who are here, thank you for coming. The Knight Foundation, Ford Foundation, MacArthur Foundation, Media Democracy Fund, and Hewlett Foundation are amongst the funders, and there's an even longer list on the website, but we're incredibly grateful that you've been willing to support this work. Which has not always been popular in all quarters, we're really thrilled, so thank you. So let me, without further ado, so what is this index and why are we doing it? So this has to do with holding power accountable in the internet age, right? And some of you have seen versions of this slide before, but you know, people are increasingly dependent on internet and mobile services for every aspect of their lives. So how these services, you know, what they let you do, what they don't let you do, what they enable you to access under what conditions, that has an increasing impact on what you're able to do in your physical life, what data they're collecting about you, who they're sharing it with, et cetera. And they also increasingly mediate our relationship with governments, for better or worse. Not only our ability to figure out who we want to vote for or political organizing, but also governments knowing what you're up to and what they're going to do about it, et cetera, or how they control what you're saying. And so it's vital from a human rights standpoint that the internet and the companies that run the internet, or much of it, are adhering to commitments on human rights and commitments to the freedom of expression and privacy rights of their users if we want the internet to be something that is actually compatible with human rights. So what is this index? We evaluated 16 companies, 8 internet companies. There are some of the obvious biggest US platforms that are used by people all over the world. But we also wanted to make sure that we looked at some companies that are not the usual US suspects, but that are used by millions and millions of people in other parts of the world. So we chose a Russian, a Chinese, and a Korean company, and we'll hear more about Kakao later. And then a selection of some of the world's largest telecommunications companies around the world that collectively, in aggregate, are operating in lots of different countries and, again, have a real impact on what people are able to access, what they're able to say, what they're able to share, and who knows what about them as they're going about their online business. So this is a screenshot from the front page of our website. I know you can't see the company names very well, but it gives you a sense of kind of how the data is organized. And as you'll see, the top scoring company is only 65%. So, you know, if this were a test, they'd be getting a D in school. But I do want to say, you know, this is a diagnostic test. This is not a certification. This is a test you take at the start of the class to figure out where everybody stands, and then we can all get to work and figure out how we can all improve. And so what does this mean? What do these scores mean? Basically, we found that anybody getting over 30% is, we felt, was making some degree of effort to respect users' rights, at least in some areas. None of them are doing perfectly. There's a lot of unevenness, as I'll talk about, but at least there was evidence of meaningful effort. Under 30% is really little or no effort. So that's kind of amongst the telecommunications companies and internet companies how it breaks down, and you can go to the website and really poke around. So the headline is, there are no winners. As I mentioned, only six companies scored at least 50%, nine companies at least 30, seven companies nearly half, were between 13 and 22. And no company in the index is providing users with sufficiently clear, comprehensive, and accessible information about their practices that affect freedom of expression and privacy. So going down into the findings a little bit, I'm just going to give you some kind of slices of certain findings that I think kind of help to illustrate what we found. So this is the overall scores for privacy. And again, I'm showing this to you not so that you can squint and look at the company names, but to see the arc of the scores. So Google overall got the highest score, but as you'll see, there's a lot of companies that whose kind of level of disclosure about what they're collecting, who they're sharing it with you, what they're doing, is kind of roughly the same. And it's kind of roughly the same mediocre kind of state, and then it kind of goes down from there. One thing that's interesting is that you will have seen in the news, of course, a lot of debates about American companies' privacy practices versus European companies' privacy practices, and that while data protection law in Europe is stronger, actually the two European Union companies that we looked at have less disclosure about what's being shared with authorities than American companies. So it's an interesting note, you know, and that's a different observation than about the law or what's happening under the hood that nobody's disclosing. But in terms of what the companies are telling users about what's happening to their data, European companies are not disclosing as much as you might assume, kind of based on the popular narrative. So to talk about some other kind of surprising findings, and when you're looking at these scores and you see, you know, who scored how much overall, it's really important to realize that when you get into the specific indicators, the specific questions, it really varies. So on the question about does the company disclose what user information it collects, how it collects this information, and why, who scored the most? A Korean company called Kakao. They got 80%. Of the possible points on that question. The second scoring company was Facebook, in terms of what they're disclosing about what they collect. Then you have a whole kind of clump of companies that all disclose the same amount. There's a lot of, it seems like almost copying and pasting from each other's policies to some extent in terms of what the standard practice is on disclosure. And then it sort of goes down from there in terms of the amount that's disclosed. So again, just because one company is scoring highest in the index overall doesn't mean it's necessarily doing best on specific questions that are really important to people, like what it's collecting and how it's collecting it and why. There's another question about sharing of user information. Does the company disclose if and how it shares user information with third parties? Again, Kakao scored highest on this. Look at where Google ended up. So again, they may have had an overall high score in the index, but there are particular indicators, again, that some people really care about, which they did not do particularly well. On freedom of expression, these are screenshots. One is a notification that Twitter provides when it withholds content on request from a government. The other is a screenshot of a block page you get on Vodafone Mobile if they block pages that they've been asked to block for various reasons. So what are some of the questions about freedom of expression? It's about things like, are their terms of service clear? Are they explaining their enforcement clearly? Do companies notify users when they block or delete content? Are they transparent about requests they're getting, not just from governments, but from private individuals, whether or not through a court, from private organizations. Are they transparent? Do they provide any information about the volume and nature of content they're taking down in enforcement of their terms of service? So on freedom of expression overall, Google got the highest number of points. And, you know, this was on a number of indicators added together. On second and third, again, Kakao scored really well. And Kakao is an interesting case of how this is not just a Western thing. You know, this is not a set of criteria on which only Western companies can do well or that only Western companies care about. We're actually seeing, you know, evidence that at least in countries with robust civil society and some rule of law, you can actually get companies really stepping up. And then Twitter doing very well. Going down into the data a little bit, I'm going to show a series of slides, less for not asking you to absorb which company did well, but just so you can see the progression of scores. So on this particular indicator, it's asking whether companies disclose anything about their process for responding to requests for, you know, taking down user information or you know, denying service. Only half of the companies in the index disclose anything about this process. And you'll see, interestingly, one European company discloses nothing. When it gets to disclosing data about government requests to restrict content or access, it's even fewer. Only six companies out of the entire index are disclosing anything about government requests to restrict content. Although I would note that after we finished, after our cutoff date for adding new information, Microsoft released a new transparency report where they did include some of this information. So next time around we do this, their score will bump up on this indicator in particular. When you get to disclosure about private requests, so not government requests, not court orders, but more sort of private requests or, you know, DMCA takedown requests, you have even less disclosure going on. Only four companies are publishing requests that they get from entities or individuals that aren't government or acting on any government authority. No companies publish any data or kind of stats about the volume and nature of content being removed or accounts being shut down in enforcement of terms of service. And this is something on which, I mean, Ellery will talk about as you know, from civil society standpoint, a concern. Now there is some good news, and what is that? I'm gonna focus the good news on what we call the commitment category. The commitment category is looking at broader institutional leadership and implementation of commitment and oversight. So things like, is there a commitment from the CEO? Are there clear company policies in support of freedom of expression and privacy? Is there oversight at the board or executive level over issues related to freedom of expression and privacy, or is it just kind of left to, you know, some staff who care about it? Is there staff training? Is there evidence that there's staff training? Is there evidence of internal whistleblowing when problems arise? You know, in other words, is the company providing evidence that's institutionalized its commitments? Is the company carrying out human rights impact assessments? So is it assessing the way in which its business is affecting freedom of expression and privacy of users and trying to mitigate that? Are they providing any mechanisms for people to lodge grievances and get remedy if they feel that their rights have been violated? So on commitment, it's interesting. The companies that scored highest on commitment are either members of the Global Network Initiative, which is an initiative that I actually helped start a few years ago, but it tries to get companies to commit to core principles on freedom of expression and privacy. They commit to carry out human rights impact assessments, and they commit to let the GNI sort of appointed assessors then go and actually verify that they do these assessments at a level of quality that's meaningful. And so what we're seeing here is that the companies that are doing best on commitment are either members of the Global Network Initiative or they're members of something called the Telecommunications Industry Dialogue, which is a group of telecommunications companies that have also signed up to a set of principles based on the UN guiding principles on business and human rights. And some of them are also doing assessments. And there's sort of discussions going on between the Industry Dialogue and GNI about possibly merging or having members of that join in the future. We'll kind of see how that goes. But in any case, it's a very interesting mix here. Specifically within the commitment indicator, human rights impact assessment, you're gonna find this interesting. Who scored best? We actually have someone from Yahoo here. I won't force her to raise her hand unless she wants to. Marissa Mayer, actually, before she came in as head of the company, inherited a business and human rights program that Yahoo had set up soon or sort of around the time it joined the Global Network Initiative as a founding member. And in the wake of some scandals over handing over of journalists and dissident data to Chinese authorities in China, and Jerry Yang, one of the founders, being called into Congress and yelled at and so on, and Yahoo has put a lot of commitments into place and is clearer in its disclosures and its information that it provides about the thoroughness of its human rights impact assessments than any of the other companies in the index, so that's something to note. I'm afraid to say that Twitter provides no evidence of conducting human rights impact assessments, and it doesn't, even from non-public information, I haven't found evidence that they do them in any systematic way. And while Jack Dorsey obviously has made a lot of statements about freedom of expression and the rights of users, we see very little evidence of the institutionalization of their commitments beyond just sort of certain individuals in the company caring a lot, which goes a long way, except when those individuals leave. So, when it comes to a company, sort of how do you institutionalize that? And then finally, on commitment with grievance and remedy, the top scoring telecommunications company is an Indian company called Bharti Airtel. The top scoring internet company is, again, Kakao from Korea. In part, this has to do with regulatory requirements about remedy, but it also just goes to show that the industry as a whole really doesn't know what to do about remedy. And this is something that Peter knows a lot about and he can comment more on. So we have a bunch of recommendations in our report on the site and so on, and you can see it online in more detail. But we're really saying, companies need to not just sort of make statements, but they need to carry out risk assessments. They need to evaluate what impact they're having on users and then figure out how they're going to sort of adjust their business practice and policies to make sure that they are, in fact, supporting users' rights. They need to be transparent and accountable, not only about government requests, and we are seeing more transparency reporting every year. Companies are releasing more information about requests they're getting, but there's a lot less information about private requests and no information about terms of service enforcement, and I think our panelists are gonna talk about why that matters and why it's a problem not to have transparency on that. We need better communication about what's happening to users' information. As my colleague Priya can tell you, we were really kind of going at the privacy policies from the standpoint if I'm a user and if I want to know, for company X, if somebody were to create a dossier on me, on everything that this company knows about me and my activities, could I be able to figure out what that company has on me? What would go into that dossier based on what that company has on me. Going through all the policies, it was really hard to figure that out. I mean, Priya and several other people, were working full time for several months just trying to work this out for some of the companies and kind of working through the scores. Users need clearer information than that. We need to understand what is known about us. It's not easy, we recognize that, but we're not where we need to be either. So there's a lot of dialogue, I think, that needs to be had about how do we get to a better place. Grievance and remedy, I'll let Peter riff on this a bit. But particularly in a world where we have governments increasingly demanding that companies take responsibility for terrorist activity online and, you know, got to do more about hate speech. And, you know, there's lots of bad things happening, and everybody's saying that companies have to police this stuff more. If we don't have, well, first of all, there's an issue with that to begin with. But as more and more pressure is being put on companies to sort of use their terms of service to enforce and so on, if we don't have good grievance mechanisms, if people don't have a way to, you know, get their account reinstated or kind of receive some kind of redress when their rights are violated in the course of, you know, companies attempting to do the right thing but not doing it properly, then there's no incentive for the companies to improve. And, you know, it's harder to prevent violations or identify who's responsible for them. And that's a really important thing that we're pretty far from figuring out how to do. Strong security practices, you know, need I say more? Go to the website and kind of see that part of it. And just for governments, just really quickly, and again, we get into this much more on the website, but there are a lot of cases where companies are prevented by law and regulation from being as transparent and accountable as we'd like them to be. And we've just got to do something about laws that do not support companies' respect for users' rights. And we need comprehensive examination and reform on that. And, you know, these governments, they're joining open government partnership and whatnot, and then, like, not being transparent about what they're demanding of companies. That's just crap, right? Mika can talk more about that. He's, you know, engaged with the open government community quite a bit. So that's it. I'm going to stop talking. And I could see our group here nodding their head. I could see other people nodding their heads. So I hope we can just have a really broad conversation, which Mika will lead.
Great, thank you.
And everybody, please come up. This one's on, in case.
Okay.
Yep.
Great. Thank you, Rebecca, for that. So just to dive right in, I thought we'd let each of our commenters take a few minutes to just sort of offer some initial response. We'll start with Peter Misek, who is the head of business and human rights work at Access Now, accessnow.org, which is an international organization that defends and extends digital rights of users at risk around the world. He also teaches at Columbia's School of International and Public Affairs on internet policy and governance. Peter, your thoughts.
Yeah, thanks, and first of all, just congratulations again for launching this. I know how much work I've seen you put into it, and I think we all benefit from the results. So, from Access's perspective, this report is really an invaluable tool for a number of different stakeholders. First and foremost, we have the companies, right? Obviously, they're the subjects of this report. But in the internet ecosystem, they're one player, and not the player that my organization really exists to support. So, who we're talking about are users at risk around the world, really vulnerable groups, journalists, activists, human rights defenders, who are forced online because of the shrinking space for civil society, for public engagement. And civic engagement, they're forced to go online to find their communities, to have a voice, even to do business. Increasingly our daily lives are forced online and forced onto these, privately owned and run platforms. Our rights are mediated by these platforms, and our access to human rights depend on their policies and on the decisions made often far, far away. Right, so we have decisions in country that telcos face. Just in Congo Brazzaville about a week ago, there was an internet shutdown timed on the day when mass demonstrations were going to hit the streets to oppose a proposal to extend presidential term limits. This is the 15th recorded internet and mobile shutdown that we've seen this year, depending on hazy news reports, you know, random anecdotes that sometimes reach our digital security helpline, and sometimes the only people we hear about it are the companies themselves from. But you know, one of the companies ranked in this report, who you know we've really targeted as one of the worst actors, and secured some high-level human rights commitments from, that's MTN. I'm happy to see that they ranked better in the commitments category than they did just about anywhere else. They have not made a public statement about this shutdown that may or may not have occurred that prevented their own users from perhaps telling each other, hey, don't go down that street. You know, the troops are assembled here. You'll protest elsewhere. You know, these are the types of messages that people depend on in the moment that shutdowns prevent. And we have struggled over the last couple weeks, fought for that company to be more public about what it was ordered to do, and they're still fighting that. And so that I think that nugget kind of shows, first of all, the importance of corporate disclosures, as they are sometimes the only actor who knows the extent of what they're ordered to do by the government and should be held accountable to the public. And this, by focusing on disclosures in this report, I think it does a lot for those users at risk in terms of notice especially.
Great, thank you. Ellery Biddle, who's the Director of Global Voices Advocacy, and Global Voices, I suppose you should say a little bit about, which is a global network of citizen bloggers in almost every country in the world where people can do that.
Only 137 countries, actually.
Only 130, that's still a lot. and she's the editor of Advox, which is a program of Global Voices Online that is dedicated to reporting on threats to online speech. So Ellery, give us your first reactions to this report.
Sure. So I think the questions about terms of service and remedy jumped out at both of us. And I guess a couple of examples that came to mind for me. One, so the Global Voices community has writers in many parts of the world. And we established a special project on free expression online when it became clear to us that this was vital to our own existence and work as writers in the internet. And we were aware of that because our blogs started being blocked. People started receiving different kinds of threats because of what they were writing online. Legal measures were taken against them. So this speaks to a lot of issues that we've dealt with quite personally. And this year, I'm sure some of you know about this case in Ethiopia that we have been experiencing for a while. 9 bloggers in Ethiopia, most of whom were contributors to Global Voices, were arrested in April 2014 and charged a few months later under the Anti-Terrorism Act there. And they were imprisoned for, some of them for 15 months and some for 18 months. And so they were actually, the last of them were just released 2 weeks ago. And interestingly, they were acquitted of a terror charge. But what if they had not been? What if it becomes, and it's become so easy to use national security and the threat of terror, whatever definition that takes, to silence critics of governments. So then when something like this happens, and I think about a company like Facebook that is always very clear in saying, we have to follow the law in whatever country we're in. We have to do, if we get a court order, most of the time we just have to do what it says. Well, if you have a court that says these people were being really critical of the government. We believe they may have intended to overthrow it, even though there's not an ounce of evidence that that's true. They're terrorists. What happens then? How can a company like Facebook or any of these guys, how are they supposed to behave in that situation?
Becca, do you want to tackle that question?
Yeah, I mean,
Mike.
I mean, this, you know, this is exactly there's a couple of different issues here. I mean, one is that from that I think companies have been facing a dilemma, and they've been making different choices in different countries, as you know, about do we go into this country and let people use it and then follow the law, or do we not follow the law in this country and just get the whole platform blocked, right? And with the exception of China and a couple of other places, in most other parts of the world, companies have opted, well, we're going to go in, we're going to engage, we're going to follow the law, but, you know, part of, you know, signing on to the Global Network Initiative is saying, well, at least we're going to be as transparent as possible, we're going to conduct human rights impact assessments and at least try and understand the trade-offs we're making and make informed decisions about what we're doing. But that doesn't kind of solve the fundamental issue for people in the Global Voices community, you know, for this problem you're stating. It's very unsatisfactory. So companies are in this difficult position where at very least they need to be very clear with users about what they're doing. But then what's the next step? And how do you empower people to actually change the situation without just contributing to the problem? And I think that's where the deeper work goes. And I think this index is showing at least to what extent are companies being open about what they're doing? To what extent are they informing users? I think the next conversation that needs to be had on top of that is, okay, these things are still happening nonetheless, and they're deeply problematic. So now what do we do?
So I have a follow-up question. And any of you can take this. You know, I was thinking about it, you know, these 16 companies are the infrastructure for more than a billion plus people in our collective digital lives. And if the engineers and designers are the people who are kind of setting up the highways and byways of that, you know, sort of digital megalopolis, what this report is really about is the rules of the road are, and whether you as somebody using operating in that space are protected or vulnerable, and that isn't really the job of the engineers and the designers to figure out, though maybe it could be. But who are the deciders? Who are the people in these companies who are actually you know, the ones responsible for the state of affairs that we have now? Is it the lawyers? Is it the board? Is it the founders? Like, who are the real deciders?
The buck stops at the top, right? And you know, the problem is that decisions are getting made at all different levels. You know, there might be a design decision that actually really affects somebody's freedom of speech, but the engineer who made that decision just has no training on freedom of expression and didn't even occur to them that it was an issue. You know, so there's that kind of thing. But then there's also kind of lawyers and, you know, or marketing people, you know, different people with different interests within the company, which is why it's important, which is why we had this commitment section, which is that, you know, it's fine for the CEO to say we believe in free speech, but you know, are people at the very working level where the rubber hits the road trained to think about these trade-offs? Is there comprehensive kind of examination, you know, throughout the company of what impact they're having and making sure that staff understand that and that people are appropriately being held responsible and that there's oversight at the board level or at least, you know, high level executive, that there's actually an effort to understand what's happening, the impact that's going on, and to mitigate bad effects. So it's not one person, but obviously, you know, the board is ultimately responsible. The CEO is ultimately responsible for what their staff are doing, you know, no matter what level these decisions are being made.
And these the repercussions of their decisions are increasingly going up to the board level. Just in the past week, we've seen the chair of a European telco resign over, you know, essentially a failure to do due diligence in entering one of these, you know, emerging markets where, you know, anyone could predict they might encounter, you know, problems of corruption, which are certainly, in my mind, linked to a propensity for human rights violations.
Go ahead.
Well, I guess something that I hope this project can help our whole community with is just understanding better how people in these big companies work together. Because it can be, different ones, there's different levels of clarity and transparency about that. But in the Global Voices community, for example, many of our writers are using social media in languages that are not major world languages, not UN languages, and they're not Latin scripts. And when they have a problem or a piece of content gets taken down, there's often the process for appeal, if there is one, the process for figuring out what happened is often very slow. And the suspicion among, really everybody, is that Facebook doesn't speak my language. Facebook doesn't speak Tamil. Facebook doesn't speak Malayalam. They have moderators, they have, the way I understand is that it's third-party contractors. They hire people who are fluent in the language, probably live in the region, and look at a bunch of tickets a day and make a decision about what to do with this piece of content. That's really important. And we know really small amount about what that work is, what kind of thinking goes into the training of that set of the labor force within this space. And I think it's a huge issue that I want to get into.
And just to kind of speak to all of this further, that in terms of the standards we're looking at and the questions we're asking, a company doing well in this index, it's the floor, not the ceiling. And it's just about sort of, is the company sort of disclosing enough that users can really understand what's happening to them in the context of the platform? It doesn't get to actually addressing particularly government abuses, because that requires a whole other set of work. But at very least, we need companies to engage in maximum disclosure about what they're doing and how what they do affects users' freedom of expression and privacy, so that users can make more informed choices about how they're using the platform and sort of who to blame for what, in a way. Because sometimes you just don't know, right? I've heard from people, say, in Hong Kong who, their Facebook account went down and they thought it was like the Hong Kong government's fault, And because nobody quite knows, who to even take your grievance to,
Right, the other thing, another point that's really, I think, quite useful for people to know is that the report does go into the variations inside these companies' services. Facebook's policies for users of the social network are not the same as for users of Instagram or WhatsApp.
Right.
And that also people may be making assumptions falsely, assuming that whatever that policy is uniform across all of their services.
That's right. We're holding the corporate entity to account. The buck stops with the board, and so we're not just looking at one service. For each company, we're actually looking at several services, several of their major services. And so we did find for certain companies, and Facebook being a very strong example, but Twitter with Vine also, an issue where you have much stronger policies for one service than another, or just total lack of clarity about whether the policies for one also extend to the other. And that's, I heard from some companies, it's like, well, but we're doing really good over here. And I'm like, but WhatsApp has 900 million users, you're responsible for them too. so that's another issue as well. And that affects the scores. So when you're kind of looking at the scores, it's the whole corporate entity that we're looking at.
So another question, and then we're going to go to the audience soon. Is this problem inherent to these companies' business model? Do you think that, given that none of them managed to get even a decently passing grade over 65, how much of this is really rooted in their business models?
Yeah, if you just took, we did an exercise where we went through and we took the highest score for every indicator, regardless of who that was, and created the sort of fictitious company that was a composite of all the high scores. And even despite the fact that we think everybody can do better on certain indicators, that still gets you to like 75%. So, and that's without even like doing the more difficult work that I think is not necessarily part of the business model. Now, there are a few indicators on which to totally get a perfect score. You have to show that you're not collecting data and, you know, that if you were really gonna get 100%. So that does speak to the business model. So, but we're like so not to the point in the scores where that actually makes a meaningful difference in the difference between scores. But we put that in there just in case we end up ranking a company in future that, for instance, doesn't store anybody's data. We don't have one of those in the index now, but it's possible at some future time. We wanted to leave room for companies whose business models are super duper privacy friendly to get a higher score. That said though, again, even without changes in business model, even without major changes in legal and regulatory structure, all of these companies can do much better.
Okay, so we're gonna open things up for questions from the room. Do we have a mic for people in the room? You can steal my mic.
Thanks, Mike.
Okay. I see somebody over there. Please just say your name and try to keep your question to phrase your statement in the form of a question.
I'll try. Thanks very much. This is very illuminating. I'm Gus from Simply Secure. Speaking of the entirety of the company, I realize I'm not sure if we're discussing lobbying attempts by any of these companies, and specifically I'm thinking about net neutrality. I learned this summer at the Chaos Communications Congress from some representatives of hackerspaces in India that while a couple of major US companies are lobbying in favor of net neutrality in the United States, they are actually lobbying against it in India because their business interest is in having, what is it, zero rate or one of the sort of low level. Yeah, I'm wondering if that's something that you're tracking and something that you've included in this, because I was sort of shocked by that.
Yeah, that's a really good question. We're not tracking lobbying in here, mainly just because we were limited in scope. And that's one of the types of things that's hard to be consistent about how you evaluate it across companies and in different places. So in some markets, like in India, you can actually get information about a company's lobbying activities. In some parts of the world, you just have no idea. And so then you might end up giving a company a worse score on lobbying just because they're doing it in a freer information environment when actually there's even nastier things happening somewhere else that we have no information about. So we wanted to avoid those types of issues within the context of a ranking. That said, I really hope somebody kind of, this is where I really make the plug for, we're creating a framework around certain research and data that we felt we were able to provide, you know, kind of at a certain consistency and standard. There's a whole lot more research. There's a whole lot more kind of investigation that I hope people are gonna hang off of this or that will build off of this in different ways. And that this is really meant to be a scaffold for people to then sort of ask, well, this just raises more questions. So we need to go research those. And I really look forward to being able to link and connect what we've got here to what other people are then kind of discovering and tracking on top of this. And that's where I think the real value is gonna be. And one of the things we're hoping to do in the next few months is really start having conversations with a lot of groups that kind of wanna build research projects using this as a starting point and really dig down in particular locations, particular jurisdictions where there's kind of more jurisdiction-specific questions that don't lend themselves to as global a ranking, but are really important for people to know more about.
Raise your hand if you have a question.
Hi, my name is Michael Cunner. Congratulations, Rebecca, great work. Question following up on the discussion earlier about companies. There are no winners, you say. And so the question becomes, is the result of, Is it the result of incompetence? Is it the result of not caring or complicity, perhaps? And then a follow-up, how do you begin to trigger change within companies? How do you change it?
That's a really good question. I mean, this is why I wanted to do ranking, because frankly, there are a lot of companies with a lot of people in them that do care about this stuff a lot. But the companies themselves don't necessarily have a lot of good comparative information about what else is possible. You know, I think it's going to come to a surprise to certain companies that cacao beat them out on certain indicators and kind of how it is that they're doing it. And we did have conversations with a lot of the companies, about half of the companies in the ranking, about their preliminary scores. And there were some cases where people sort of made the case that, you know, what they're currently doing is all that they can do. And then we're now able to point to examples of there's somebody who's actually doing more. And I think it's not that they were lying, it's just that they perhaps weren't aware because there hadn't been that kind of very comparative analysis, you know, looking at the question in exactly the same way. So I'm hoping this can be a real tool for the companies because there are a lot of people in these companies that you know, want to move the ball in the right direction. So but it varies from company to company. I think there's some companies that really haven't thought about these issues that much. In some markets, there's not a lot of stakeholder pressure or media pressure, or you know, there are just kind of other issues going on, or people just don't know. There are some places where users just don't realize that there might be another way for companies to do things, and that there are actually examples of companies doing, you know, being more transparent or having different types of practices. And so I'm hoping that this ranking will help kind of illuminate that and incentivize companies. I think we've seen in other industries, you know, as you know, since you do investor advocacy, that, you know, the more you kind of put out the information, companies are further incentivized. And so some of it's priority. Like I spoke to somebody from a company that's not actually in the ranking. I won't name the company or the person, but you know, I was asking, why doesn't your company do X, Y, and Z, you know, along the lines of what we're looking at in here? And this person said, well, our CEO thinks that if our users aren't demanding it, you know, aren't just breathing down our necks demanding it, it's not a priority. And as you know, human rights is not always the first thing that the public is, that the tyranny of the majority is demanding. You know, they're oftentimes demanding delightfulness and ease of use and you know, fast video, right? That's what the majority is kind of demanding the most. But you know, for the people who need this stuff, it can be life and death. And they may be a minority of users, but from a human rights standpoint, you have an absolute obligation to have, you know, to be doing everything you can to respect their rights. And so the hope is that this kind of helps prioritize this and that it provides the questions that investors can ask of these companies. I think questions, in terms of questions that companies get asked, it's been sort of uneven as well. So I'm hoping this might provide a little bit more of a focus. I'm hoping that, just as we've seen some indexes on sustainability and labor practices have kind of helped move the ball, because it just kind of helped promote shared learning, not just among the companies, but also amongst activists and investors and other stakeholders, just about what's possible and provides a framework for a conversation. I'm hoping we can do that too.
I would add to that I think that some companies are starting to think more about usability in relationship to fundamental rights, whereas I think 5 years ago it was more likely that the policy team was in this sort of unattractive corner of the office while the people actually designing the stuff were like having all the fun and they were kind of talking to each other. It in some contexts, I mean, I think at Google for sure, it seems to be happening more, that there's more thinking about, well, what are the different ways that we can serve users and create products that people can choose to use that are more privacy sensitive, that are a bit safer, and that make the user experience actually easier somehow. That's sometimes thought of as kind of impossible, or those two things just can't work together. But I see developers moving in that direction in some companies and NGOs, and I'm excited about that.
Thank you. My name is Corey Abramson. Thank you all for all the work that you're doing. Looking at the report as a tool, you were obviously limited in your scope and your time and how many companies you could work with and how many wanted to work with you. What are your plans to promote the report and connect smaller companies or newer startup companies with the information so that they could, from the get-go, have good practices as opposed to having to correct them down the road?
Great question. We're working with a lot of groups, including Peter, and Peter can perhaps talk to that as well. But we're going a lot around to a lot of gatherings and, you know, hanging out at RightsCon later next year, just to really meet with groups. I'm going to the Internet Governance Forum next week to meet with NGOs and academics to talk about how they want to use this. And to really encourage people to kind of build their own projects off of it. I have also heard from people, you know, frankly, I'm quite happy for people to kind of actually find business opportunities in this. So I think there's a lot of consultants that work with startups that can help them take this and figure out how to apply it to their situation. I totally welcome that. This is out on a Creative Commons attribution only license. You know, we want people to use this. We want this to have as much as an impact as possible.
Yeah, I would just add for the, you know, especially the larger corporations and the telecoms definitely count. We're going to pull the levers of the corporate machinery. You know, many of these companies are structured where you can attend the annual general meetings. Shareholders can put forth resolutions. There are a lot of activists and impact investors out there who are very experienced dealing with labor issues, the apparel sector, you know, the extractive sector. They just are not aware of perhaps what the risks are in the information and communication technology, the tech and telecom sector. So this report helps define those risks, first of all. And you may call them non-financial, you know, reputational, whatnot, but they do go up to the top and hit the bottom line. And then once you, you know, can educate these, you know, pensioners up to the equity fund chiefs on what those risks are, this provides a roadmap with, you know, just really rich and hard-hitting information about the actual steps that companies can take, you know, whether they're a startup or a multinational telco.
Thank you. My name is Matthias. I'm a journalist from Berlin and on the board of Reporters Without Borders, the German section. And of course, I'm most interested in the observation that you made about the European companies that have apparently a very stringent data protection regime, but are not following human rights so much. Or I'm I'm a bit mean here. But my question is, there is a discussion, of course, in Germany and in Europe about data protection being the right means to further human rights, and some people arguing that, well, it's not. And apparently your report gives credibility to that notion, but is that your take on the results as well?
That's a good question. I mean, just to clarify, because we're looking at disclosure, so if a company is doing things to adhere to data protection law, but it's just not explaining what it's doing to users, then they're failing to get credit based on our methodology. But I guess that's the point, is that we're finding with some companies in some markets, they're talking to regulators, but they're not talking to their users. So they're not explaining to their users what's actually happening. So this is more, this is less about what's happening under the hood that nobody sees, or that maybe the regulator has confidential access to, and more about what is the company telling their users about what's happening to their information or their ability to speak. So just to kind of make very clear that this is more about disclosure than it is about, you know, practice that cannot be seen outside of the public eye. Because that's what we're able to measure. But we're also taking a view that
companies need to communicate these things to users, and that only talking to regulators and not making clear to your users what's happening in the process of your compliance with regulation is not sufficient, ultimately. So just to be clear about that, there were a few cases where the companies say, well, we comply with regulation, but they say nothing else. And on our methodology, you don't get credit for that. So we can have a debate about that as well. But for instance, in the case of Orange, their privacy Orange France doesn't even put its privacy policies online. And it's like, come on, folks. we could do better than this. But it's tough. I think there is an issue about compliance versus have you really institutionalized something? And there have been people who've written about that as well. And this certainly, it kind of adds to the debate. I don't think it really comes down on one side or another conclusively.
So actually, question from Twitter, from David Sullivan, who asks, what are the top three things companies could do to raise their scores next time around?
So, well, there's, there's the hard things and the easy things, and the low-hanging fruit, and I'd love to hear what you guys, I'd love to hear each of your own versions of this, but, the seriously low-hanging fruit are things like, some companies just lost a lot of points because while they disclose what they do in response to government requests, they have no disclosure about what they do around private requests, and particularly around kind of user data questions. Depending on the jurisdiction, there's some jurisdictions where sometimes companies hand over data on private request, even if it hasn't come through court order or a government process, and other countries where that tends not to happen, but companies often don't even clarify anywhere in their public materials whether they entertain private requests, and that's just sort of, so there's a certain things that are just no-brainer, and then you talk to somebody in the company privately, and it's like, well, of course we don't entertain private requests. It's like, well, why don't you tell your users that? Because there's actually a lot of users who suspect that you do. I think many people in the GV community. There's some things like that where just being clear about what you're doing in different circumstances could take things a long way. Basically just disclose everything that the law doesn't prevent you from disclosing that is possible. Is real. So there's a lot of companies that. They're not. The law doesn't let them disclose data. So, like the number of government requests they get, the law won't let them do that. But the law doesn't stop them from disclosing basic information about how they handle requests, like what their process is, what their policy is for receiving requests. The law doesn't prevent them from doing that. So, go up to as far as you can in terms of the types of disclosures you're providing. Don't just say, well. The law, and the other is that there are a lot of, I guess the third thing is, we found a lot of cases, particularly in countries that are tend to be known as democracies, that have rule of law, where the company is like, if the law isn't requiring it, they just don't get around to it. So there are some countries where, because the law doesn't make them disclose certain things, they just won't do it until the law forces them to do it. And so we just need companies to be more proactive and perhaps use this as a roadmap about what they need to be proactive about.
Yeah, I have an answer for David, which is I think that every company that allows users to report on each other, to flag content that they think is violating terms of service, or to flag an account that they think is violating terms in some other way. A key example being Facebook and their real name, authentic identity policy. I think they should release data about that because there's a stunning amount of stuff that is online and then it goes away and then it comes back, and people whose accounts are suspended indefinitely, suspended until they provide some information, but they're not really sure what happens to that information once they send it off. And we just don't really know. We're kind of, it's been a huge issue that Peter and I both have been working on a lot in the last couple months. And we can point to these cases that are really scary and sort of staggering, particularly in the area of disclosing people's identities in situations where they're not actually prepared for that. And we're just totally in the dark. We have these great particular examples from people who have been willing to share their stories because of how upsetting or sort of passionate they are about the issue, but we could know so much more if we had that information.
Yeah, and just to add, we want our policymakers to have evidence-based, data-driven policy, right? We want companies to act the same. If you want civil society to produce our, you know, our guidance based on, you know, the state of affairs, then we need to know what's happening on your platforms. You need to give us that actionable data, and not in the form of, you know, a press release, but the real hard numbers. And then just to throw on, digital security, data security practices, and encryption, especially end-to-end encryption, is one area where a lot of these, I think all of the companies essentially failed. If you're really confident in the security of your systems and your networks, you should be able to disclose why you're confident, you know, how often you update, what standards you use, and just how much encryption you're using. Encrypt All the Things is an Access Now campaign that really puts it forward that, you know, end-to-end encryption works, and it needs to be offered wherever possible. In the form of PGP keys or otherwise. Starting is just to be honest and forthright about what practices you're currently employing.
Another question there. Hi, Madeline Earp. I work on Freedom House's Freedom on the Net report. I'm curious about the effect that this could have on public opinion and the possible chilling effects that misinformation about company policies can have. I mean, it's often a problem that we face, that researchers, even experts, will come to us and say, well, this is Facebook's policy. Or, you know, there'll be a transparency report that'll be misquoted or distorted. And we'll say, well, where's the source of this? And say, oh, these 50 news reports. You know, and it's just widely believed that this is a practice which is not actually supported in fact. And that's also susceptible to manipulation by governments who say, oh, it's the company's fault, as a way of distracting attention from their own practices. So our official answer is always to say, well, more information, more transparency will defeat misinformation. But in some areas that I research, I wonder if that's really true and how long it takes.
That's a really important question. And I just want to give a shout out to Freedom House and the Freedom on the Net Index that just was launched last week. It's the month of launchings. And and what was really interesting about the finding, you know, one of the top line findings in this year's report was the increased pressure on private platforms to carry out government restrictions and surveillance and so on. But you're absolutely right. There is this issue of kind of what information to believe. And actually, for most of our indicators, we didn't count press reports. There were a few very notable exceptions, which we kind of noted in the researcher guidance that's in the indicator document. But for All of the indicators, with the exception of a couple in the commitment section, where it was appropriate to be a little broader about what we looked at, press reports don't count. You know, it's like, what does the company itself actually say on its own platform? You know, not what the CEO said to the Financial Times or, you know, whatever, or what was reported in an Indian newspaper about what Twitter was saying off the record or something. That none of that counts. And that's because it's not verifiable. So we're really only looking at
the company's disclosed policies. Now, it's also true that what we do not have the capacity to do is then go on the ground in all of these places and examine, is this policy that they claim, is this practice that they have disclosed and the statement they made about what they do, is that what we're actually seeing on the ground? Or are we seeing something else happening that kind of disproves the statement? So we did not go and kind of fact check the company's statements about like whether their statements are completely consistent with what people in the Global Voices community are actually experiencing out there on the internet in various countries. What we're hoping is that since we've now provided basically this set of data that's based on what companies claim they're doing, not on what somebody in the media was told by somebody who works at Twitter off the record, but what companies say they're doing, is that I'm hoping that people in your network and people in the Access network and the Global Voices network, this is now the opportunity to go and say, okay, we now have a repository of what the companies say they're doing, and we're going to call attention whenever we find that actually something else is happening, or the company, based on our experience and our documented evidence, is doing something different than what they claim in that policy, here it is. And that our kind of this layer of research will hopefully provide sort of the basis for the next layer of research, which is kind of verification on the ground at a more local level where the rubber's really hitting the road, where people are really experiencing these things.
Okay, why don't we get these three questions, let's get all of them rounded up together, and that way we can take rapid fire. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Anne-Marie Pointe. I'm a lawyer and also a design strategist from Pratt Institute. I'm really curious to see if how your indicators will actually be evolved in the future, if any of these commitments talked about privacy by design, data protection, legal protection by design. I'm curious if you encounter that with your findings.
Mm-hmm. You mean whether we oh, I'm sorry,
next right. Year, sure. We'll, yeah. Yeah. Privacy by design is one.
Hi, Rebecca. Congratulations once again. And my name is Jacqueline. I'm a law student. And I was interested in, as a regular user of Kakao, I was interested in Kakao, of course, as an outlier. And I'm curious, how much was it due to government regulation, but also how much was it part of, due to user expectation of the user base, where, obviously if the users are so used to collections throughout years and years, they would obviously feel more comfortable giving up their, certain levels of privacy, and Kakao as a result would feel more comfortable being transparent of data collection. So and what would be the takeaway of Kakao being an outlier? So that's my question.
Thank you. My name is Torben, and I had the pleasure of working with your colleague Alain Barr at the Berlin-based think tank, so that's basically why I'm here. I'd be interested in whether you've been in contact with these companies before today's presentation, and whether there's been any feedback or interest in their own performance in the index.
So kind of privacy by design, et cetera, we don't use that term in our indicators because we asked very specific questions that enabled us to really identify particular behaviors and policies. And privacy by, so we ended up like not using in the indicators themselves sort of things that tend to be buzzwords like privacy by design, or we didn't even use net neutrality in the indicator that actually looks at net neutrality. We used terms like network management and sort of other kind of more fact-based terms about what is actually happening. But that's certainly part, is sort of implicit, I think, in what we're looking at. And certainly the methodology will evolve over time. Right now, for this iteration, we looked at internet and telecommunications companies only. There's no device companies in here, so Apple is not here, Amazon is not here, Samsung, we like to expand it to include a somewhat broader range of companies for very obvious reasons. When it comes to the question about Kakao, I mean, they're a fascinating company, and some of their kind of privacy policies definitely relates to regulation. Some of it relates to just kind of scandals in Korea recently over surveillance, and I think a strong civil society that's demanding more transparency. You know, so Kakao issues transparency reports, and you know, I think they're not the only Korean company that releases a transparency report, but not many Asian companies are doing transparency reporting. But they are showing that, you know, you don't have to be a Western company to do this, and that there's demand. Korea is a, you know, it's a democracy. It's got sort of robust multi-party system, and also kind of a certain, you know, half the society distrusts the other political party pretty strongly, it seems. So there's a lot of incentive to, you know, want more transparency, it seems, as well. So those are all factors. And that politics is, you know, Korea was the first country to elect a president thanks to internet organizing. So, you know, so people really see the importance of that for their civic lives. And that seems to be part of it, too. I mean, I'd love to hear, you know, somebody could write a fascinating paper about what's going on in Korea. That kind of segues to our engagement with companies, and Kakao did engage with us along with about half the companies in the index. What we did in terms of the engagement was several things. One was, as we were developing the methodology, we reached out to a broad universe of companies that were likely to end up getting ranked or were kind of in the zone of possibly getting ranked, and asking, you know, them for feedback, reaching out to companies at various conferences and so on, letting them know this was happening, putting various iterations of our methodology online so that, you know, people could see this coming from a million miles away. it's not a surprise. And giving them opportunity to give us feedback. We did a pilot study in which we talked to the companies about their results, even though we didn't release them publicly. And for the index itself, we contacted all the companies that were in the index at the start of research, saying, you're the lucky winner of being included in the index. We'll be in touch with you in a month or so with your initial results, and you know, we will welcome your feedback at that time. And so about half the companies did take advantage of this opportunity to give us their feedback, and it helped us. You know, it was very helpful in you know, just in terms of our making sure that we were evaluating the indicators in a way that was consistent with the reality of how the companies function, while at the same time, you know, we didn't always, you know, some companies are saying, well, my score should change on this. We didn't always agree with that either, but it was very important to have that dialogue, and this is really just the beginning, because this is not sort of this stone tablets down from the mountain about here is how the world must be according to the ranking digital rights team, you know, and this is our verdict. This is a conversation starter. This is, you know, we've applied these standards based on widespread consultation with experts, building on a whole set of different kind of emerging privacy standards, knowledge of many experts, you know, human rights standards that are increasingly widely accepted. We've built it on that. But some of the details about where we need to be, how we get there, what ideal policies and practices really should look like, we need to have a conversation about that. And so this is really meant to be, again, the framework for a conversation with companies, a framework for a lot more research by a lot more people, framework for a lot more advocacy, et cetera. So it's a starting point.
So we're almost out of time. I do want to say one thing, even just following the Twitter stream here, it's clear that Yahoo's business and human rights department has already posted something on their Tumblr blog saying they're looking forward to continued conversation. They're going to study the report. So that's, you've already had an impact with one of the biggest internet companies. My last question for the panel, and if you can just take a minute each, is with the Freedom House report that just came out, which clearly says that freedom on the net, at least in terms of government influence on people's freedoms, is getting worse globally. Which way do you think the pendulum is swinging? And Do you have any optimism, perhaps, about the behavior of companies compared to the behavior of governments?
Ellery starts crying.
I'm afraid I don't. Yeah. And I often hope that that's because sitting from where I sit, how would I? I get, every day I edit a story about somebody getting arrested because of something they said on either Facebook or Twitter. There's so many of the problems here touch that. I think we're getting to a place where the company, well, for example, in how you ask users to identify themselves and what kinds of information they have to give you in order to use their service, it does implicate, you know, there is, at what point do John Ruggie's principles on business and human rights, which say if you could prevent a human rights violation from occurring, and you can kind of see that, you should, as a big company such as these are. I think that maybe there's a bright spot in efforts like internet.org or Free Basics or whatever it's called, where there is, it's scary on one hand because it's a narrowing of the internet, but the response to it in a place like India has been fascinating. I mean, there's a lot of pushback and opposition, and it's not just from elites, it's from people who get what this means and want the company, if they're gonna do this stuff, to do it differently. So there's a positive thing.
Thanks, yeah. I agree. I think the space for civic action is shrinking. Governments are generally seeing the internet as a threat. It's more incumbent on companies, I think, than ever to understand that they have, you know, a responsibility to respect human rights and to jointly, where possible, with governments, provide access to remedy. But, you know, if independent courts aren't an option, they need to look within and see what they can offer in terms of, you know, resolving grievances as efficiently and painlessly as possible. I think the tech sector, tech and telecom sector, has a real golden key in its pocket, which is that people actually like their products. They're not going in and setting up mines that destroy communities. They're, you know, providing in many ways connectivity that people depend on and want. And so if you're looking at, you know, remedy, it's often just turn it back on, but, you know, be a little bit more transparent and secure in how you do that. And, you know, coming off of the big, you know, global connectivity push at the United Nations, people, you know, I think recognize that infrastructure and technology is the way to implement all, you know, 17 and a half or whatever of the global goals. And we just want to ensure that takes place within a rights-respecting framework, that human rights come hand in hand with our connections.
Yeah, I mean, companies we're at this kind of crossroads right now. Companies can be part of the problem and can be part of exacerbation of the problem, or they can, at least some critical mass of them, can be part of the solution, or at least contribute to a solution, or at least prevent things from getting any worse than they already are, you know, sort of some level there. But I think companies need to recognize that whether or not it's their intent, they are becoming part of this problem. They're part of the ecosystem that is the problem. And again, companies that really want to think about what do we need to do to make sure that this globally interconnected network maintains its value and doesn't become so balkanized and so full of distrust that it loses its value by any sense of the word value, you know, they need to be part of the solution. And they're gonna have to think creatively and innovatively, right? These are some of the most innovative companies on earth. Let's get to work with some more innovation here. So short term, I think we're, you know, the winter is here. A few years ago I said the winter is coming. And it's gonna, you know, we gotta slog through this winter, but, you know,
I'm optimistic about sort of, as a historian's daughter, I think in the long run, there's cause for optimism.
Well, that's a great note to end this morning panel on. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you to Rebecca MacKinnon and the whole Ranking Digital Rights team for this great new report. Go to rankingdigitalrights.org to read the entire thing, and it's really rich. There's a lot of great material in there. Peter Misek from Access Now, Ellery Biddle from Global Voices Online, thank you as well for enriching the panel. Everybody else, thanks for coming. Again, you're always welcome here at Civic Hall, and hang around, there's coffee, and I think our folks will hang around here as well to talk for a few more minutes, so have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ellery.
Sure.
Pinch hitting.